Good morning, Antioch family. We're going to be in John chapter 1 this morning, so if you want to take your Bibles and turn there, and we'll read our passage. We've been going through Luke on Sunday mornings, and we've been going through the life of Joseph on Sunday evenings. We're going to put those on hold, and we'll come back to them when we have the opportunity to be together again as a church family. But in John chapter 1, we're going to read from that this morning. Let me just, while you're finding that, let me make some announcements. I hope that you'll take advantage of the resources that we're providing on our Facebook page. For those of you that have Facebook, you can go to our page. We have a family worship guide for you to work through during the week, and we hope to continue to be posting those each week as long as we're in quarantine and not able to meet together. And so we hope you'll take advantage of that. John chapter 1, and beginning in verse 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through Him, and apart from Him, nothing came into being that has come into being. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. There came a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify about the light so that all might believe through him. He was not the light, but he came to testify about the light. There was the true light, which coming into the world enlightens every man. He was in the world, and the world was made through him. And the world did not know him. He came to his own, and those who were his own did not receive him. But as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, even to those who believe in his name, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we saw his glory, glory as of the only begotten from the Father, full of grace and truth. May God add his blessing to the reading of his word. We have a special treat for you this morning, as my oldest daughter Marlon is going to come, and she's going to sign for us in a time of praise.
Took
Well, amen. Thank you, Marlon, for that. If you turn back now, if you closed your Bibles to John chapter 1, and we'll look at the passage that we just read a few minutes ago. You know, many people who are on the fringes of faith, those who regard themselves as maybe seekers or maybe as agnostics, really have made the matter of Christianity harder for themselves than they need to. They jump off at the wrong places. They jump off for the wrong reasons. They usually start from the premise that Jesus was a remarkable man, that he was a godly man, that maybe he was a prophet. And because they start there, they stumble over the claims of the New Testament. And so because they start from the premise that Jesus was just a good man, they stumble over the virgin birth. They stumble over his atoning death on the cross. How could the death of a Galilean carpenter provide the salvation of all of mankind? They stumble over the resurrection. They stumble over the miracles of the New Testament. And when you talk to them, that's the answers that they give to you. Well, I'm interested in Christianity, but I can't believe Christianity because I can't go with all of this stuff. Now, in fairness to them, if you start with the premise that all that Jesus is merely a good man, that he was a godly man or maybe a prophet, if that's all he was, then understandably, you'd be ready to jump off at the virgin birth and the resurrection and the miracles. But you see, they're making it harder for themselves because they're focusing on the wrong things. They're asking the wrong question. None of those things are ultimately the supreme mystery of Christianity. The fundamental mystery of Christianity is the one in which we're confronted with here this morning in John chapter 1, where John confronts his readers with the staggering claim that Jesus of Nazareth is actually God made man. That Jesus is none other than God, the creator of the universe. And what we need to say to these people is we need to say, hey, you know, wait a minute, not so fast. Don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. Before you reject Christianity, how about you read the Gospel of John along with me? I'll read it with you. And then maybe agree to meet with them weekly. And work through it and see the claims that it makes for this man, Jesus of Nazareth. Now, as I pay attention to what's going on, as I listen, as I learn, and as I look at social media during these last couple, 3 weeks, I realize that there are many people who will be watching who normally don't tune in to our YouTube channel or our Facebook page to hear the messages. And maybe there are people who are interested in Christianity. And maybe there are those people who are watching who you are on the fringes of faith. And it's imperative for those of us who are entrusted with the responsibility of teaching and preaching the Word of God that we should address those issues. So for the next few weeks of quarantine, however long that lasts, we're going to be looking at the question, who is Jesus? Just who is this Jesus of Nazareth? What is this Christianity stuff really all about? And let me just say that what I'm about to share with you this morning can be found in any systematic theology. This is not original material with me. And in fact, you may come across a book called No Other Truth by a guy by the name of Bruce Milne. And you may say, you know, I think Fred got some of his stuff from there. And you'd be right. And you may come across another book by J.I. Packer called Knowing God. And you may get to the chapter on the incarnation. And you may say, I think he got some of it from there. And you would be right. And that's just to mention two of the sources that I'm dependent upon this morning. And so if you've got the outline, there's an outline on our Facebook page on the post with this video. And so if you found that and you've got it and you'd like to take notes and follow along, feel free to do that. And we're going to begin with the Roman numeral 1, which is the reality of Jesus. the reality of Jesus. That's Roman numeral 1. We just read here in verse 14 this classic statement about the coming of Jesus, that the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we saw his glory, glory as of the only begotten from the Father, full of grace and truth. Now, the person of whom John writes is introduced to his readers in these preceding 13 verses that we just read as the Word. The Word, capital W, Word. And he says a number of things about the Word in these verses that are not new to many of us, but they're important that we remind ourselves of them and that we do so constantly. And so I want to give you six things as we go through these verses and answering the question, who is Jesus? And the first thing that we find here is letter A on your outline is that the Word is eternal. The Word is eternal. That's how John begins his gospel there in verse 1. In the beginning was the Word. The Word is eternal. When we think of Jesus, many of us will probably immediately in our minds think of Bethlehem. That's understandable because many of us think of Christmas as being the arrival of Jesus, of his coming to earth. But if we think of the beginning of his existence as being at Christmas, then we're mistaken. We're thinking wrongly. The beginning of the Word doesn't begin in Bethlehem. The beginning of the Word actually doesn't even begin at creation. And throughout the years, theologians have sought to try to hammer this out and to come up with little pithy statements to make sure that nobody would have any doubts to this truth. And so they came up and they said, there was never a time when he was not. There was never a time when he was not. And the people who opposed that, they responded and said, there was when he was not. And so in reply to that, they said, there was not when he was not. There was never a time when the Word did not exist, because the Word is the eternal being. When creation took place, the Word was already in being. And theologians explain this in phrases like unoriginated or uncaused or independent of any other form of existence. And so when your children ask you those deep, deep questions when you're tucking them in bed at night, then you're going to have to tell them that this Word is unoriginated, uncaused, and independent from any form of existence. And then you're going to have to tell them what unoriginated means and uncaused means and independent from any other form of existence. And by the time you can explain that to a 7-year-old child, then you'll have grasped something of the truth of it for yourself. But until you can explain it to a 7-year-old child, you and I probably don't understand it. John MacLeod, commentator, says the incarnation was the intrusion and eruption of the eternal into the existence of man. The intrusion and the eruption of the eternal into the existence of man. Not the creation or the coming into existence of the Word, but the Word breaking the barrier between time and eternity and appearing in man's time-space capsule. The Word is eternal. That's the first thing. The second thing, letter B on your outline, is that the Word is creator. The Word is creator. Look at verse 3. All things came into being through him, and apart from him, nothing came into being that has come into being. Now, this is a vital phrase, not only for understanding who Jesus is, but also for understanding our world and where it came from. And again, when our children ask, well, where did the world come from, Grandma? Where did the trees come from? I've been studying the Continental Divide in school, Grandpa. Why do you think the rivers flow the way that they flow? Why do we revolve this way and that way? And all these kind of questions that they ask, which of course intersects with science and physics and everything else. But at the end of the day, you need to be able to say to your grandchildren, the Lord Jesus made all of this, you know. He is the creator. The Word is the creator. Sounds kind of weird in the 21st century, doesn't it? Because we come out of a world where just about everything we see and everything we hear challenges this very idea. And we come out of a world that makes Christians feel like we're the silliest of all people to believe such a notion as this, that the Word is the creator. Now, I don't think we should be backed into a corner at all. I think we should go out boldly and challenge their silly ideas. Not rudely, but we should go out cheerfully. Their theory says that if you give an infinite number of monkeys, an infinite number of typewriters, they'll eventually produce the complete works of Shakespeare. I mean, that's what they say in their theory, that you're just a turbocharged monkey. And that, frankly, we could put some monkeys in here and they could do just about anything that you do. A few years ago, there was a headline in England. And the headline read, "Monkeys typing is a mess." That was the headline. And according to the report, they said, give six monkeys one computer for a month and they will make a mess. Researchers at Plymouth University in England reported that monkeys left alone with a computer failed to produce a single word. They pressed a lot of S's, said Mike Phillips, a researcher on the project which was paid for by the Arts Council. See, it's the same in Britain as it is here. If you want money for dumb stuff, just go to the Arts Council. If you can't get research money for diseases that's killing people, but you can get it for dumb stuff like this. But that's another topic. That's almost political. And never talk about politics or religion, okay? But it goes on to say the researchers left a computer in the monkey enclosure at Paynton Zoo and then waited. Eventually, the monkeys produced only 5 pages of text, primarily filled with the letter S. At the end, a few A's, J's, L's, and M's were struck. So you got half a dozen monkeys in a room with a computer, and they're just going like this, and they're just pressing the S button over and over. And if you'll give me some grace, the very final sentence of the article says, and another thing they were interested in was defecating and urinating all over the keyboard. Well, you get the point. Monkeys left to themselves just make a mess. Now, when you read, in the beginning was the Word, and all things came into being through him, and apart from him, nothing came into being that has come into being, it clearly flies in the face of our modern notions of science. And there's no reason for us to shy away from it. In fact, there's every reason to stand up and to affirm it. To say we are not here as a result of time plus matter plus chance. That we are not turbocharged monkeys. We have our own DNA. We were purposefully fashioned by a creator God, and the Word was there in the act of creation. So that in the words of the songwriter, who made the mountains and who made the trees? And who made the rivers that flow to the seas? And who placed the moon in the starry skies? See, the Christian doesn't answer that by saying some impersonal, blind, capricious, and malevolent force. No, the Christian says the Word did it. The Lord Jesus did it. The same one who knelt in the Garden of Gethsemane and sweat great drops of blood is the creator of the garden in which he knelt. So the Word, first of all, is eternal. The Word is creator. Thirdly, letter C, the Word is God. The Word is God. Go back to verse 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. Last phrase, and the Word was God. The Word is God. Now, this is the core of the Christian faith. To say less than this is to deviate from the Christian faith. Watch out for wolves in sheep's clothing. I encourage you all the time, listen carefully to every word I say. Pay attention, lest you be led astray by foolish men who would distort the truth and draw people away after them. To say that Jesus, the Word, is anything less than God is to move beyond the truth of the Bible. There's a great hymn that we don't sing anymore, but it says, "Who is he in yonder stall, at whose feet the shepherds fall? 'Tis the Lord, O wondrous story, 'tis the Lord, the King of glory. And at his feet we humbly fall, and we crown him, Lord of all." Now that's a song. That's a song. It gives voice to that which takes hold of our minds and transforms our hearts and fills our lives. Who is he who stands and weeps at the grave where Lazarus sleeps? 'Tis the Lord, O wondrous story. 'Tis the Lord, the King of glory. And you're saying to yourself, God weeps? God cries? Who is he who from the grave comes to succor, help, and save? 'Tis the Lord, O wondrous story. 'Tis the Lord, the King of glory. See, this is something far greater than a Jesus that we can just put into our pocket and pull out whenever we need him. This is something far greater than a Jesus who just exists to add to the sum total of our happiness. I mean, it's not surprising that J.B. Phillips wrote that book, Your God is Too Small. And many people have rejected Christianity because we've offered to them such a small God. We don't demand them to think. We don't demand them to submit. We don't demand them to give up their pride. And it all seems so trivial to them. It seems irrelevant to their lives. But when we go to the Bible and we allow the Bible to speak, then our minds must bow before the immensity of this. You see, in saying that the Word was God, John is giving the Word the greatest title of God in all of the Old Testament. He is Elohim, which is the plural name of God that expresses the most intense form of his deity. One commentator says, he is the summation of Godhead, the one whose being makes that of all other gods not only superfluous, but impossible. Now let me say that again. You may not get it this morning, but one day when you're driving your car down the road, it might hit you. And you might say, oh, that's what it means when we deal with Islam. That's what this means when we deal with Buddhism. That's what it means when we deal with the Jehovah's Witnesses or when we deal with the Mormons. He is the summation of Godhead, the one whose being makes that of all other gods not only superfluous but impossible. Now, that's a very exclusive claim, isn't it? Jeremiah chapter 10. You don't have to turn there. Let me read it for you, but you just listen. If you want to turn there, you can. Jeremiah chapter 10. And listen to what God says through the prophet. Jeremiah 10 and verse 1. Hear the word which the Lord speaks to you, O house of Israel. Thus says the Lord. Do not learn the way of the nations, and do not be terrified by the signs of the heavens, although the nations are terrified by them. For the customs of the people are delusion, because it is wood cut from the forest, the work of the hands of a craftsman with a cutting tool. They decorate it with silver and with gold. They fasten it with nails and with hammers so that it will not totter. Like a scarecrow in a cucumber field are they, and they cannot speak. They must be carried because they cannot walk. Do not fear them, for they can do no harm, nor can they do any good. Now, what an encouraging word that is to people who are surrounded by all of these inferior gods with a small g. And listen, to the extent that your friends and your family and your coworkers and your neighbors are tied up with all of these other gods with a small g, they can do them ultimately no good. And they can do the true believer no ultimate harm. So Jeremiah goes on to say, "There is none like you, O Lord. You are great, and great is your name and might. Who would not fear you, O King of the nations? Indeed, it is your due." Now, who is this Elohim? Who is this God? The eternal Word that John introduces his readers to here in his gospel. So when the Bible says the Word is God, it gives to him the greatest title of God in the Old Testament. It says that Jesus possesses all the attributes of God. He is eternal, he's omniscient, he's unchanging, omnipresent, omnipotent, holy in his mercy, his righteousness, and his love. The Word does everything that God does. Creation, preserving and sustaining the universe. Colossians 1:17 says, "And in him all things hold together." Why is that? Because the eternal Word not only created the universe, but he sustains it and preserves it. And the glory due to him is exactly the glory due to God. And that's why in Philippians it says that every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Now, I'm sure that there are some who are watching this right now are saying, "Well, I'm not sure this is really all that important. I mean, all we really need to do is just reduce the message to love, love, love. All you need is love." No, that was the Beatles. That's not the Bible. The Bible says that God and the Word are one and the same being. Jesus encapsulated it when he said in John 10 and verse 30, "I and the Father are one." And of course the people said, "Well, this can't possibly be. I and the Father are one. What does this possibly mean? What can this mean?" Well, it means this, that Jesus is not a second God. He is not an addition to the original. He is Yahweh. He is the only God, the God who was and is to come. And we need to understand this so that we can talk to our Muslim and our Jewish friends, because they are hung up on thinking that God is one, and they're saying, "But you're saying he's three." And we say, we're saying no. We're saying that he is one. And in his oneness, there is the expression of his threeness. And they say, "Well, I need to sit down and have a cup of coffee and think about this." Well, I understand. Let's both sit down and have a cup of coffee and talk about it. It's absolutely vital that we understand that Jesus does not derive his being from his Father. Calvin said he was autotheos. He is self-God. He was God in his own right, co-equal, co-eternal, possessing the very deity of the Father. Now that is the supreme mystery of Christianity. It's not the miracles. It's not the virgin birth. It's not the resurrection. Don't let anyone fall off the wagon over the miracles or the resurrection. If you're going to lose them with this supreme issue, which is that Jesus said in John 14:9, "He who has seen me has seen the Father." Jesus said, "You see me? I am God." Did Buddha ever say that? Never. Did Muhammad ever say that? Not once. Did Krishna ever say that? Not at all. Jesus said, "He who has seen me has looked right into the face of God." So the Word is eternal. The Word is creator. The Word is God. Fourthly, letter D, the Word is a person. The Word is a person. Again in verse 1, and the Word was with God. You see that right there in the middle of the verse? The Word was with God. He was God with God. Now this is where our kids can help us again. Because they say, well, wait a minute, Dad. You know, before you turn the channel on the TV, could you just explain that to me? God with God. Jesus is unreservedly God, but he is not the totality of God. The Father who is God and the Holy Spirit who is God, along with the Son who is God, make up the totality of God. Each member is unreservedly God. No one member is the totality of God. Father, Son, and Spirit are not just different names for the same person. It's not just different faces of the same God. Now, I could take you a lot deeper than this, but I'm trying to give it to you in little bites because I want you to understand what I'm saying. And if you need to pause the video, you know, that's one of the great things about doing it like this. You can pause it, think about it, hash it out, and then mash play again. Because there's people who say, oh, well, I get it. There's one being, and one day he shows up as the Father, and the next day he shows up as the Son, and then another day he shows up as the Spirit. I see, that's what it means. No, that is not what it means. This is not one being wearing three different masks. This is not one being with just three different names. If it were, you couldn't have the Word being with God. You couldn't have the Word being sent by God. You couldn't have the Word forsaken by God. My God, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? You see? Well, in order to try to fix this problem, some people have gone all the way to the opposite extreme. And they say, well, no, what it means is there are actually three different beings, three distinct gods. But no, that's wrong too. There are actually three eternal distinctions within the one God. Distinctions that are so personal that each loves the other. And together, they make up the triune life of which the very essence is love. Let me just give you in one verse, and then we'll stop here and draw it to a close, and we'll come back to it, hopefully, maybe next week. We'll just make this into a two-part sermon from the time that I see here. One verse, probably the most famous verse in all of the New Testament. John 3:16. For God, that's Father, Son, Holy Spirit, co-equal, co-eternal. For God so loved the world that he gave, the Father gave, his only Son, that whoever believes in the Son, who is one with the Father, should not perish, but have everlasting life. Now, if you're a Christian this morning, let me just tell you what happened to you in this process. If you're not a Christian, this will give you an idea of what needs to happen if you are to become a Christian. If you look back on your experience, if you look back to a time when in a moment or maybe in a crisis over a period of time, you became a Christian. If you look back on that experience, you discovered that God the Father planned your salvation. He loved you before you loved him. You discovered that God the Son secured your salvation. He died in your place. He bore your sins. And you discovered that God, the Holy Spirit, applied that salvation to your heart and to your life. Not three separate gods, but one God, one substance, three distinct personalities. Co-equal, co-eternal, with a whole universe to care for. And he came knocking at your door, and he saved you. And we act proud, and we trivialize the gospel, and we let a secular world out there push us into a corner as if we're nuts. Show me a worldview that answers these deep questions. You say, you're sophisticated, you're too smart for this. There's enough here to keep you going for the rest of your life. You cannot reject Jesus on that basis. Search the scriptures. If you cannot explain it to your children and your grandchildren, then you don't know what it means. We'll pick it up from here next time. Let me close us in a word of prayer. Lord Jesus, we thank you that you are the Word, that you became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld your glory. And Lord, as we preach this Word, Lord, we see your glory, that you are eternal, that you are our Creator, our Sustainer, that you, God, are God, and that you are with God, and that you planned our salvation before the foundation of the world. The Son secured our salvation, and Holy Spirit, you apply that salvation. And God, there may be somebody watching this video on social media, and they've been interested in Christianity, and God, you may be drawing them to yourself. You may be knocking on the door of their life. Lord, I pray that they would search the scriptures, that they would take this gospel of John and they would read it, that they would consider the claims that it makes about this man named Jesus of Nazareth, and that God, you would draw them to yourself. I pray that you will be with my church family. Lord, I long to see them. I long for us to be able to gather together again. But God, until that moment, I pray that you will provide every need, and that God, you would grow us in a way that when we gather back together, we are so much stronger in the faith than we were when this all began. And I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.